and a colt tied, or an ass tied, and a colt with her, untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, you shall say, the Lord has need of them. And he will send them immediately. This took place to fulfill what was spoken by the prophet, saying, tell the daughter of Zion, behold, your king is coming to you, humble and mounted on an ass, and on a colt, the foal of an ass. And the disciples went and did as Jesus had directed them. They brought the ass and the colt, and they put their garments on them, and he sat thereon. Most of the crowd spread their garments on the road, and others out cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. And the crowds that went before him and that followed him behind shouted, Hosanna to the Son of David! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord! Hosanna in the highest! And when he entered Jerusalem, all the city was stirred, saying, who is this? And the crowd said, this is the prophet Jesus of Nazareth, from Nazareth of Galilee. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
There are a fair number of church people out in our denomination and a lot of other denominations that don't think that church is supposed to be fun. I know this because I have run into quite a few of them and gotten into trouble with quite a few of them. What is fun? Fun is a spirit of enlivenment within our souls. And theologically speaking, in order to have fun is to experience enjoyment. And enjoyment means, on a spiritual basis, living in the joy of the moment. And joy is a quality of God. We are all called to be joyful people, fully alive. We are all called to be a part of things in such a way that really the enlivenment of our souls, it's what happens. It's supposed to be fun. Fun. When I look back upon that first Palm Sunday, what I see and what I imagine, I think is a great spirit of enlivenment. I think there was a great deal of fun to be had when Jesus entered the city of Jerusalem. It was a parade. Yeah, I think that's a parade. Now, I know you have parades in Cheyenne, Wyoming. I went to the Christmas one. I think there are some associated with Frontier Days and other particular occasions. When my children were young, we lived in Normal, Illinois. It is the only respect in which I've ever been normal. And Normal is the twin city to Bloomington, Illinois. They exist together, and every so often, every few months, they'd have a parade. And the kids would, you know, the kids loved to go because all the floats and the marchers would throw out candy, and they always liked to get a lot of candy. It was the home of Catherine Bike Candy headquarters. And one year, for a couple of years, my daughter Corey and I, my older daughter, were part of the Indian Guides and Indian Princesses organization, and we had got to march in the parade. Now, one of the things that I learned while marching in the parade is that it's not nearly as much fun as watching it. You don't get as much candy, for one thing. But what also happens is that you see a variety of people, but you don't see what's happening in the parade itself because everything in the parade is going on behind you or going on in front of you. And so the fun of the parade, I think, is somewhat diminished when you're marching in the parade rather than watching the parade happen. Now, Jesus was, I think, a one-float parade, riding on a donkey. And he was kind of marching band, politician, social organization, as well as church representative, all wrapped up into one. And all the people gathered around him, and they shouted, "Hosanna, Hosanna, blessed is he, as one comes in the name of the highest." And then some of those people who didn't think the church was supposed to be fun started criticizing him. Tell your people to be quiet. And as Marty so wonderfully demonstrated through a giant pitcher full of purple goo, or blue goo, he proclaimed, "If my people were still, the very stones would shout out to the joy of God." Now, Jesus was in the parade. Was it fun for him? Who knows? My guess is that part of what was going on in his mind was what he was about to face. He was going in and cleansing the temple and taking on the power structure and trying to turn Judaism upside down, and then facing later on his arrest and crucifixion. So whether or not he was having fun at that moment, again, who knows? And that's what Jesus did. He went into Jerusalem. He cleansed the temple. He took on the power structure in order to turn Hebrew society upside down, and then he began the process of turning all humanity upside down through crucifixion and resurrection. Partway through that week, he told two of his disciples to go and find an upper room and start the preparations for a meal. They were making party plans. Do you like parties? I like parties. You get together, you gather over food and beverages, you have remarkably silly or occasionally wise conversations, you let your hair down, behave a little foolishly, although I've never seen anybody at a party wearing a lampshade on their heads. Maybe that's a bucket list type thing, I don't know. It won't be me, of course, when I say that. Anyway. And so Jesus and his disciples gather for a party, observing a celebration that to this day is now probably the oldest continually observed dinner party in the history of humanity, the Passover, the Pesach meal, celebrating when the Israelites were called by God out of Egypt, and the angel of death passed over the Israelite people to strike the firstborn of the Egyptians. So was it a fun party? Who knows? Jesus, however, took and made a couple of adjustments to the normal Passover format. First of all, when his disciples came in, he put a towel around himself and he washed all their feet as a sign of servanthood and telling them that this is the way you are to treat others as leaders of the church. You're to be servants. You're to wash their feet. And then following at the end of the Passover meal, he started a new observance, something that we recall being in remembrance of me, so that his body is always called to lift Jesus into the presence. And then there was the cross. Not fun. Not fun at all. Though enlivening for all of humanity. I don't know, probably one of the many things that you don't yet know about me is that I'm a recovering Star Trek junkie. And I say I'm in recovery because I didn't see the last Star Trek movie, so it must mean I'm over it. Nevertheless, there's one of my favorite movies is called Star Trek Generations. And in that movie, Captain Jean-Luc Picard of Star Trek The Next Generation and Captain James Tiberius Kirk of the original Star Trek get together in a place that's called the Nexus. It's kind of a land where all your dreams come true. And Jean-Luc Picard goes to Kirk because the Enterprise and a third of the galaxy have just been destroyed by the passing of this Nexus and the activities of a mad scientist to help make it happen. And Picard goes to plead with Kirk to join him in exiting the Nexus and saving the galaxy. And he says, and Kirk says, so the universe is at stake, we're facing impossible odds, and it's just you and me against the entire world. Sounds like fun. And they go. And they battle the mad scientist, and they save the Enterprise in that quadrant of the galaxy. But in the course of the battle, Kirk is wounded. And wounded fatally. And so, in one of the last conversations you ever have, James Kirk, before his next reincarnation in Christopher Pine, of course, he says to Picard, after the battle's over and he's lying there dying, it was fun, wasn't it? And then he dies. Now, in no way am I equating Jesus Christ with James Tiberius Kirk or vice versa. But I think the point engaged in this little scenario of what happened in that movie is very similar to what the goal that Jesus had when he entered Jerusalem. He went in Jerusalem in order to foment a spiritual revolution that would make a difference to every single human soul henceforth and for all eternity. And if we are to have fun with life, the Christian call is a call to not just have fun for our own self and our own souls. It's to engage in enlivenment in such a way that good news is preached and homeless people are sheltered and hungry people are fed and all sorts of things happen that build in an enlivenly way the beauty of the world. The call of Jesus Christ extends to all of us. Maybe it's against somewhat impossible odds, but we are called to go out and make a difference. The story of this Holy Week is the story of making an eternal difference. For in Jesus' death on the cross and the power of his resurrection from the dead, it allows each and every human soul to be enlivened in such a way that the joy of the Lord is available to all of us at all times. Ministry in the life of the church. Yes, it could be a lot of fun. Be alive, my brothers and sisters, as you enter this Holy Week season. In the name of the Creator and the Savior and the Sustainer. Amen. We invite you.